And I walked away.
Yeah, we clogging up the pipeline. Word on the streets, they miss me since I put the mic down. Since I put the mic down. They say they miss me, nigga, since I put the mic down. Yeah, we clogging up the pipeline. Word on the streets, they miss me since I put the mic down. Now they pick the mic up. Tell them to cry for back and we piped up. I'm from the planet where them apes at. If it wasn't for this music, I'd probably be trapping out a vape shop. A couple of choppers on deck with the safes locked. In the trenches, nigga, chasing down the sack like Jay White. They wanna see a nigga fold, bitch, I think not. Mashing, making cash off the glass, nigga, bank shot. MSMG tank top, bitch, we poolside. Lemon drop, shrimps and scallops on their food side. The doja will keep my composure on the cool side. And playing with me, I drop my windows and let the tool ride. Me and baby bumping heads, I'ma smash out. I'm on that all move, swinging like a glass house. All these risks I take, that's the reason I'm boss. And when they throw salt on my name, they just season my sauce. They say it's love, it ain't no love, they just thinking I'm lost. I just tell them likewise, but my fingers is crossed, nigga. Yeah, we clogging up the pipeline. Word on the streets, they miss me since I put the mic down. Since I put the mic down. They say they miss me, nigga, since I put the mic down. Hey, we clogging up the pipeline. Word on the streets, they miss me since I put the mic down. Now they pick the mic up. Tell them to cry for back, and he piped up. I heard they looking for the kid, I'm on my grind, homie. And if a nigga tell you something different, then they lying on me. I swear a nigga can't stop me with my mind on it. They say you gotta trust the process, I took my time on it. Track killer, fell in the flow, I commit a crime on it. Cash out, send me the beat, I'ma spit a rhyme on it. The grapevine say they hatin', here we go again. Who gives a fuck, I'm in his mouth, finna blow a 10. And once I blow through this 10, I got more to spin. Getting to it, and y'all be going out, I be going in. When it's time for me to eat, dawg, I'm hogging and flexing. Like it's Thanksgiving, that's the table, dawg, in the dressing. And even though I fall short, he continues to bless me. And when they ask me how I'm living, I say I'm living my best.
Living my best.
Yeah, I'm living my best one. Was out of time for 6 months. I used to live with my Mexican. Yeah, we clogging up the pipeline. Word on the street.
What's going on, world? What's the deal?
It's your brother, Travis McCray, Kofi Poseye Research Team. I really don't plan to be long. I got to go to work in a little bit. I'm hoping it's not going to take a long time. But peace to whoever may be watching. And I'm going to go ahead and get in. If you can hear me, can I be heard? Let me go on my little phone. Let me check YouTube how I sound. I'm good. That's a bet. Can't find a damn card tonight. That's right. Like the show, share the show. Like I said, it shouldn't take too long. I pretty much just like pre-did, but Black History Month. Oh, hold on. I think I gotta go like this. Go like that. Oh, all right. Black History Month with KPRT. My personal focus will be centered around the rich and little known Black history in Houston, Texas. Yeah. Trash internet.
Before I start this presentation off, I want to just encourage y'all
to go get our new, brand new publication, Spirits of Victory, Volume 5, packed full of Black history information. Our books pretty much are A1 for teenagers, kids, and adults. If you're in school and you have, say, a Black history project or something, these books are full of sources that'll take you to the direct information if you want to further expand, or you can just cite us, you know what I'm saying, and utilize us, because we stay with plenty of information. We're doing, I feel like, the best research on YouTube in this community. So support Black authors and entrepreneurs, and enjoy your Black History Month. I'm finna go ahead and start y'all off with this presentation by our good sister, Nunu, aka Brianna Evans. So enjoy.
Oh, that's hot. That's hot.
Founded in 1836, Houston, Texas is the home and grounds for many of my family members, starting as early as 1913. The city holds incredible historic events and is the foundation and the reasoning behind this presentation. There are several historic events that made Houston important. For example, the Camp Logan Mutiny, the Houston Riot of 1917, the Houston College for Negroes, now TSU, established in 1947, and Ovie Duncantel, the founder of Houston Black Heritage, was also established in 1974. These are just a few examples, which brings me to another important milestone in the city called the Acres Homes Transit Company. In 1910, land developer Alfred A. Wright completed the first of several subdivisions that eventually became the African American community of Acres Homes. Acres Homes, a region not yet considered to be inclusive with Houston, Texas, was established during World War I. Between 1914 and 1918. In 1920, Sammy A. Ford, a resident of Acres Homes, reported to the Houston Chronicle that most residents had gardens and raised chickens and hogs, quoting the neighborhood as like it was the country and a place where people had to help each other. These large areas were often divided by the acre and not by the plot, hence the name Acres Homes. By the 1940s, the African American population numbered 86,302, or 21.4% of the people in Houston. Due to African Americans moving from Louisiana and other parts of Texas, the population increased to 125,400 by the 1950s. In 1957, Negro Life magazine described Acres Homes as the largest all-Negro community in the United States. As time passed, conditions started to decline, and rural settlers moved out of the area, and realtors began marketing the area largely to African Americans. In the fall of 1958, the Yale Street Bus Line, a suburban, privately owned transit company, ceased commuter services in Acres Homes. After the loss of their main transportation resource, it left the predominantly African American community of Acres Homes with no public transportation. Affected by the change of the transportation line, African Americans were forced to adapt and were left with utilizing jitneys or small used car taxis driven by independent operators, mainly residents of the Acres Homes community. This was risky because they were in open violation of municipal transportation codes. In 1959, several residents from the area, including teachers, ministers, businessmen, and civic leaders, petitioned City Hall for a permit to operate a suburban bus franchise from Acres Homes. On July 1st of 1959, the City Council granted a temporary permit to the company, the Acres Homes Transit Company. Four buses made 43 round trips a day between downtown Houston and Acres Homes. The Acres Homes Transit Company became the first bus franchise in the South owned and operated by African Americans. 8 years later, in 1967, Acres Homes was finally annexed to Houston. The Acres Home Transit Company board members sold the company to the Houston Rapid Transit Line, the largest privately owned transit company in the city, in June of 1968 for $5,000. Today, Acres Homes, also known as the FOFO, is still upbeat and increasingly growing. According to the 2018 American Community Survey, this predominantly African-American community has a population of 36,708 people just in the neighborhood alone and continues to grow. Well, family, I hope you enjoyed the presentation. And remember, peace and Black power.
All right, my connection to Acres Home comes via my father and his parents, which you can see to the left. That's my grandmother and my papa when they was young. He really looks like me. If you see pictures, when I had a bald fade and whatnot, he favor like crazy. And that's me. In this picture, smiling as a baby with my grandmother. She's been deceased I can't even tell you how long, but she's been gone for a while now. Sweetest lady to ever walk the planet. But that was my anchor to Acres Home. Every time we came to Acres Home, gotta go to my grandmother's house because that's my dad's mom, it's his parents. He wanted to visit his parents, so we always go off of TC Jester, where his house now is taken over by my aunt Angie. She renovated it and whatnot, but this is my connection. Acres Home First Public School, White Oak Color School, was established in 1915 by Harris County Common School District 26. The two-room school building located on West Montgomery Road under the helm of head teacher Miss R.J. Mosley housed grades first through eighth. As the population grew and more families migrated to the area, a second teacher and third room was added for the 1930-1931 school year. The Wright Land Company later deeded a Harris County Common School District 26, White Oak School District, 5 acres of land located on West Montgomery and Willow Street for a new two-room school to be built. The new school, Highland Heights, opened on September 19, 1932, with Miss R.J. Mosley as the head teacher. However, the structure was not finished opening day. As a result, Miss Mosley improvised using the running board of her car for an office chair and her lap for a desk. Consequently, school was dismissed and parents and students were asked to return the next day.
On the second day, 89 students enrolled, creating a need to hire a third teacher to accommodate the large increase in enrollment. Miss Bessie M. Catchings was hired to teach first through third grade meeting a great Zion Baptist Church. Although school conditions were unfavorable, programs were favorably because it was unquestionably
In 1945, community members petitioned the school board for a new permanent facility. The request approved on September 30th, 1949. The new Wesley facility, Green Wesley, sixth graders. Area first, second, and third grade was left at old location, Highland Heights, and fourth, fifth, and sixth graders were bused to Wesley. However, to eliminate the busing, the school board elected to create boundaries separating the two schools as a result of return to their original.
Highland Heights is located on Paul Quinn.
Okay, the significance of this Texas Historical Commissioner marker for George Washington Carver High School is it talks about when Alding was absorbed. So I'm gonna skip a little bit into the marker because a lot of it's already been said, but start where it says, the school moved to Wheely Road in 1941, continued to grow under Archie Baldwin Anderson, who served as principal from 1941 to 1957. Under his direction, the school changed its name to George Washington Carver School, received accreditation, and separated into an elementary and high school in Acres Home, leading to construction of a new high school building at the location in 1954. The former campus was renamed Carver Elementary and later dedicated to A.B. Anderson Elementary. In 1978, Carver High School became Alding Contemporary Education Center, implementing an innovative program to attract students who are not African-American to this campus. The curriculum consists of flexible hours and voluntary enrollment for students who work or had special interests. In 1994, the school changed names again before becoming a magnet school. Many graduates have achieved personal and professional success, and today, George Washington Carver High School for Applied Technology, Engineering, and Arts continues to be a notable institution of learning in the community. Yes, and a quick fact here is my wife's big mama actually told me all this before I even read this. She actually attended Carver Elementary right before it changed names and turned into a high school and split. And what's interesting about that is this is the school that my kids go to.
And that's my kids and wife at A.B. Anderson Academy. It's a real good school. White Oak Colored School, Acres Homes first school for blacks became A.B. Anderson Academy.
On May 17, 1954, the United States Supreme Court ruled unanimously in Oliver Brown versus the Board of Education of Topeka, the racial segregation in public schools violated Equal Protection Clause of the 14th Amendment to the Constitution, which prohibits states from denying equal protection of laws to any person within their jurisdiction. This decision declared the separate education facilities for white and African Americans were inherently unequal. In an effort to reduce opposition and unrest to the decision, the Supreme Court permitted state attorney generals to devise a plan for how to proceed on desegregating public schools. The justice handed down a plan on how it would proceed on May 31st, 1955. Desegregation was to proceed with all deliberate speed. However, it took many years for the state to fully desegregate their schools. Say, long live George Franklin Sampson, man. This is an interesting that I came across in my research a long time ago, and pretty sure like people aren't familiar with him here or anywhere else, but he was pretty much responsible for the Aldine School District, making the Aldine School District accept black kids pretty much. Like, he took them to court because they didn't want to let his sons in Aldine, if I'm not mistaken, but we're gonna get into that moving along to the next slide. But it's a very interesting dude, just the time frame. You would think, you know, it was Martin Luther King that had that people like this guy was pivotal, you know what I'm saying, and making change by taking these people to court, you know what I'm saying, and holding them to the laws that they're supposed to uphold. He attempted to get some fair treatment, but we'll see. Move along. Sampson made his living in an unusual way. He was a house mover by trade. At the time, there was a large demand for house movers in the Acres Home area of Houston, where Sampson and his family lived. Sampson and his family were one of the pioneer families of Acres Home, which got its name because of the land was sold by the acre and not by the lot. The subdivision is now one of the largest black communities in Houston. Sampson's occupation was not only unusual, but hard, manual labor. It was harder than one might suppose because he moved houses with very large, strong mules rather than with winch trucks like most other house movers. Sampson owned two sets of mules, one for his work and the other for wherever he needed to go, by mule or wagon. In fact, he was still moving houses by a mule as late as 1969. Jeff's workday did not start and end with house moving. First, there were animals, including ducks, goats, hogs, chickens, cows to feed, to take care of. There was also garden to tend, and the garden contained edibles such as. He also butchered and prepared his own meat. Sampson's hard life probably reinforced his desire to seek a better life for his children. Not surprisingly, Sampson was a civil activist who spoke out for have the right to vote. he members of his family went in mass. Powerful. Samson felt that everyone should have equal rights. When residents of Lakers Home considered hiring a private water service, he campaigned strongly against it, for he felt blacks should not let the city of Houston ignore them. He argued, why should blacks pay a private company for services the city already providing it for its white citizens? Paying private companies for services that should have been provided by the city of Houston was an example of the measures blacks felt they had to take to obtain equality. After Supreme Court handed down its decision in Plessy versus Ferguson, 1896, blacks and whites had different and supposedly equal facilities for all public convenience, such as bathrooms, water fountains, phone booths, and I cut that off. So, but
it says schools.
My wife's grandfather, Papa James, who I had in a slide, he was alive around that time, so he wanted one of them old schools that can't stand white folk. Now, the irony is that, you know, I think his dad is actually European descent, Papa Travis, which is wild because, you know, he's like my color, more on the same day, but he expressed to me, you know, how they used to treat basically black people like shit on the buses around that time. We all know about all sitting in the back and just the real poor treatment that our people had to deal with coming up out of slavery and going in the gym, Reconstruction area and then Jim Crow and whatnot. Separate, however, was rarely, if ever, equal. One example of this inequity was the bathroom facilities. The cleaning staff was often instructed to clean the white bathroom thoroughly, while the black bathroom received little or no attention. Another example was the rule that required blacks to enter business establishments through the back door. Given the racial climate in Houston at the time, it's not surprising that a lawsuit would be necessary to integrate the Aldine schools. When Samson learned he could not enroll his sons at Aldine High because they were black, a federal suit was filed on behalf of Samson and his sons. The Aldine district was charged with the following allegations by the Justice Department. Student attendance was patterned and drawn corresponding closely to the racial residential patterns. The district made facility and staff assignments on the basis of race. The district had manipulated grade structures and had constructed schools according to racial patterns. Black students at Carver High were discriminated against by the quality of curriculum and other activities. So that's why he wanted his kids to go here. I mean, this is the same district as you get Brittany Griner. My wife went to Nimitz with Brittany Griner. Partner went to Aldine school. My kids been in Aldine since they've been going to school. It's a really good district. Although Samson and his sons won their case, implementation of the rules did not come before Vernon and Chelsea had completed high school. Finally, in 1965, Judge Joe Ingram, United States Circuit Judge, signed an order integrating the Alden Independent School District. G.F. Sampson lived until November of 1983. His work for equality in the Alden School District, however, is still evident today. Thanks to his efforts, students in the Alden District can attend any school within their area. G.F. Sampson made it possible for students of any race, color, or nationality to receive an education. And that's why I thought this was a slept on dude. That move right there, like, that opened up doors, you know what I'm saying? And then it was a stiff move. He could have just, you know what I'm saying, laid down, but I guess it's in, you know what I'm saying, in being from the 44, you know what I'm saying, you got the squawk. Ruby Lee Sanders Mosley was born on April 25th, 1929 in Mexia and moved to Houston in 1948. She enrolled at Franklin Beauty College and became a licensed beautician. And after graduating from high school, she attended Prairie View A&M University. She was a health coordinator for 18 years at Gulf Coast Community Services, advocating to provide water, sewer, and other city services to residents in Houston's rural communities. She then joined the City of Houston CUNY Homes Housing Development as a community service supervisor. For 13 years, she provided essential services for senior citizens and children. She retired in 1995. Throughout all of that, and later on in her life, her dedication to the historically African-American community in Northwest Houston was undying, her family and friends said. Mosley, who is known as the mayor of Acres Home because of her tireless efforts to support the Northwest Houston neighborhood, taking on issues from education to housing to voting rights, died in February 2020 after an extended period of illness.
I don't know why I keep on stopping.
Her family said she was 90. The most important thing about her legacy is that
she was a champion for this community.
She was a champion for this community.
I don't know why it's doing that.
Said grandson Damian Price, 42. She was all about.
Y'all can read that.
Marlon D. Gomez, EMG Santana, born August 24th, 1988, July 30th, 2019 is the day that he died.
Creator of the Acres Home Anthem. You know what I'm saying? As I close this presentation out, I feel like it's only right, you feel me, to take this opportunity to, you know what I'm saying, big up my cousin, the blood cousin, my family. To me, you know what I'm saying, he is a part of Black history, you know what I'm saying? They, you know what I'm saying? They know that boy is the North Side General, you know what I'm saying? It's a real solid individual, man.
plenty of times this dude then looked out for me, man, and bought him and his brother, man. We grew up, I'm talking about, I used to come out from San Diego to my granny house and I'd catch him, him and his brother and the rest of his siblings, you know what I'm saying? They'd pull up at my granny house. He used to dribble the ball in front of the porch, you know what I'm saying? Get our handles together. He was nice. His brother was nice. And his little brother right now still hoops, CC the Jig, you know what I'm saying? Checking my neighborhood hoops. The boy still hooping, putting it down. Nice with it. But, you know what I'm saying? We used to always either be on some hooping stuff or them boys used to be rapping. And him and his brother used to, man, they used to be able to memorize these raps. That was just like, we'll be thinking we finna freestyle. And I'll be like, nah, nigga, y'all niggas not freestyling yet. You know, I don't know what y'all niggas, this can't be the Houston representation, y'all. You got this memorized player. But the boy, them boys stuck with it, you know what I'm saying? That boy went from just, you know what I'm saying, neighborhood. Like, everybody I know used to know this dude, man. Like, him and his brother, it don't matter what part on the north side, the niggas home area you go, somebody knew them. As soon as I left out my mama house and got to, you know what I'm saying, on my journey, exploring the H, everybody knew my cousin, man. Everybody knew this dude, Marlon. They knew him when he was in high school. They used to get into it with, I forgot them boys' name. Boys on Government, Hollywood clique. They used to jump them boys. I remember one time they jumped them niggas real bad. Him and his brother, Hollywood clique, jumped them niggas. I think it was on Ike or some shit. But them boys used to stay. You know what I'm saying? Either on Gulf Bank, you catch them boys on TC Justo, you catch them boys in Garden City, you catch the boys at their mama house in Inwood. You know what I'm saying? You catch them at the park, you catch them boys anywhere, man. Boy was a neighborhood star, real player cat, man. One of the most player cats I know, man, used to get all the girls when we was in high school, man. That boy was in. Because he mixed with black and Mexican, so he had that long hair, man. And you know what I'm saying? We both were short and stocky, could hoop. But that boy was just, he used to just get more play than him. I used to respect him, you know what I'm saying? And the crazy part was, as far as his respect go, street wise, man, boys on Titwell had utmost respect, all the little homies. I remember it was a blood that used to try to press me out of here. And we was at Clifton Park. And my cousin was just happened to be up there, and this nigga came up there. That nigga told that nigga, say, man, chill out, bro. You gonna have to dead that. That's my people. That's my cousin. You know what I'm saying? And I'm talking about this dude literally cut that shit out, and I never had an issue with this dude again, ever. This dude was a whole blood, like really on the cool. I think my cousin was associated with that. Him and his brothers by family, man. The boys always been by family. They always been by the community. You know what I'm saying? So I had to add him in here. I got some, I'm gonna end it with exclusive performance. I'm Hold on. Presentation. I hope it was insightful and informative. You know what I'm saying? Appreciate anyone who sat through the whole thing. Like and share it. Subscribe to our channel. you know, buy from our businesses. Go Get Volume 5 is out now. Get Kofi Book. Get all these books. Educate yourself. Share this knowledge, man. Support the channels. Share the shows. And I'll be back with some more Acres Home history and Houston history next week. Holla.
That's it. How do I take this out? Move that out. Yeah, that's it, man. What's up, Chatel?
What?
You can hear me, kid? Oh, you just lurking. That Buster Tip always lurking.
What's up? Nah, I was on here for a minute, boy.
I didn't even see. I was looking it in.
Yeah, I know you was up. I was like, shit. But I was looking at the screen. I had to start doing something up. I'm here, though. Yeah, when you turned that video on, I had a ran to the bathroom. Yeah, I've been on here.
And it was a straight presentation.
Yeah. You did your thing on there.
Appreciate that. Boy, I say burn one. Yeah, man, I gotta get ready to go to work. So I ain't have my ass up off of here on cool. If there's some questions, I might ask us some questions real fast, but I plan to try to knock out part two sometime next week. You know what I'm saying? Get some more, you know what I'm saying? Get some more information. Try to touch on some stuff from out of volume 5, you know what I'm saying? Because people need to go get that. You feel me? But if it ain't no questions, I'm about to make a move. Cause I ain't even much, really got no sleep, kid. I got off and sat up trying to make sure this shit was working right, messing with this. But luckily, it's peaceful up in here, you know what I'm saying? The kids at my mama house. And I got my little thing situated, so everything pretty much panned out pretty well.
All you need, now you gotta do is throw some WD-40 on that chair, boy. Get that. Nah, but yeah, you got a nice little setup, though.
So appreciate you, appreciate you. But yeah, man. I don't see no questions. So I'm about to send y'all out with this little video from this book that I'm trying to get this whole out. Trying to get it out. Ain't certain really on a date yet. Cause I had a bunch of people that was, you know, people that's in the video that still ain't, you know what I'm saying, came through, but you know what I'm saying, this ain't gonna be the only one. We plan to keep on doing these, so hey, but this is a little video I had made for the book, and we out.
Claim your Africanness. I'm telling you, when you claim your Africanness, you're gonna get your mind back and you're gonna get your intelligence back. I'll guarantee you. Education, and when they take responsibility in terms of their own Africanness and their own identity, when they don't spend all of their lives trying to escape from their Africanness, when they don't believe that what you be called African is a curse, you see, when they don't run from their Africanness, but they run to it, and they embrace it, and they become a part of it. Let's see what happens to their learning when they decide and say out loud that I'm black and I'm proud, and that I'm African and I'm proud. Of individuals, society, systems outside, everything, that is logically impossible. And it's a stupidity that you perpetrate on the population of our people, and often leads to serious misunderstandings, both myself and our situation.
goddamn hard to me, kid.
I did that shit, nigga. That shit so hard.
Kid. You made that beat?
No, that's really a instrumental from off of, that boy Dave East, one of his tracks off the, I think the most recent one, kid. That boy had a bunch of, he stay having some fire production, you know what I'm saying? But I had took the instrumental and then threw that boy Amos Wilson on that hoe, you know what I'm saying? Let him speak to the people, but let me get out of here, man. I gotta get ready to go to work on bullshit. I'll let y'all end this on.
Yeah, man, that was good.
Appreciate that.